lectures sponsored by the Hallie Ford School of Graduate Studies. My name is Shauna Lipton, and I am chair of the MA in Critical Studies here at PNCA. PNCA is located on the traditional homelands of the Multnomah, Klamath, Clackamas, Tualatin, Kalapuya, and many other indigenous nations of the Columbia River. We acknowledge the ancestors of this place and understand that we are here because of the sacrifices forced upon them. By recognizing these communities, we honor their legacy, their lives, and their descendants. Tonight, we are thrilled to host Dr. Sammy Schock, an assistant professor of gender and women's studies at University of Wisconsin-Madison. Her research focuses on disability, race, and gender in contemporary American literature and culture. Schock's first book, Body Minds Reimagined, Disability, Race, and Gender in Black Women's Speculative Fiction, published by Duke University Press, explores how Black women writers use non-realist genres to reimagine the possibilities and limits of body minds, challenging our understandings of the meanings of disability, race, and gender. Schock's next project focuses on disability politics in Black activism in the post-civil rights era, and that's what she's going to be speaking with us about today. Please join me in welcoming Sammy Schock.
Good evening. How's my sound? Is any more? Let's get this a little bit closer. Better? Awesome. So if at any point during the talk, if I need to slow down, repeat myself, speak louder, just gesture at me in some way. We're a nice small crowd. If you did not get a chance to grab an access copy on your way in, there are access copies on the table where you came in. Access copies are literally just a physical copy of everything I'm about to say to you. It's useful if you like to follow along, if that's helpful for you for understanding. I ask that you don't like circulate this into the world. It's still a draft. I'm working on it, but please use this if it would help you to follow along, or if you're here for class and need extra credit and you want to like use it to write your paper, no problem. Totally fine. Otherwise, just please make yourself comfortable in this space. Access is a priority, so if you need to get up, move, stim, turn a chair around to put your feet up, do whatever you need to do to be comfortable in this space. Okay, so the talk today is called 504 and Beyond, Disability Politics and the Black Panther Party. On May 7th, 1977, the cover story of the Black Panther, which is on the screen here and will stay up for the entirety of the talk, the weekly newspaper of the Black Panther Party read, "Handicapped Wind Demands End Hue Occupation." The page included three images. The first photo features two Black men, a wheelchair user, Brad Lomax, and his fellow Panther member, Chuck Jackson, who stands behind Brad's chair. The second image is of a blind Black man named Dennis Phillips holding up a protest sign that says, "You don't have to see to know." The third picture is of a crowd of people of various races outside of a building with a seemingly non-Black woman wheelchair user in the center of the frame. Cover stories are reserved for the most important or pressing news of a particular moment. The choice to place a disability rights activist win on the cover of a Black activist newspaper is undeniably symbolic of the party's belief that the success of the Hue occupation, now more commonly referred to as the 504 sit-in or the 504 demonstration, was not merely important news, but news relevant and connected to the Panthers' own anti-racist, anti-capitalist, and anti-imperialist work. The placement of the success of the 504 demonstration on the cover of the Black Panther is in many ways the height of the disability politics within the Black Panther Party. It is the most explicit and symbolically significant moment of coalition and solidarity with disabled people in the entirety of the paper's publication from 1967 to 1980, and thus provides a launching point for this talk. In most scholarly accounts of the 504 demonstration, the role of the Panthers is relegated to a brief mention that the party provided food throughout the 25-day occupation of the San Francisco Health, Education, and Welfare, HUE, regional office. Though several scholars of the Black Panther Party have written about the party's community survival programs and health activism in the 1970s, no Panther scholarship discusses their involvement in the 504 sit-in. Only Sue Schweik's Lomax's Matrix, Disability, Solidarity, and the Black Power of 504, which is an article, provides extensive scholarly engagement with this history. However, recent publications by disabled activists who were at the sit-in and the Longmore Institute's Patient No More Traveling and Digital Exhibit on the 504 demonstration have added new details on the role of the BPP as well. My talk tonight builds upon this work to further assess the BPP's engagement with the 504 sit-in, arguing that the Panthers supported the demonstration because disability rights and anti-ableism fit within their existing revolutionary ideology, even as disability was rarely an explicit part of the party's liberation agenda. My talk comes from my second book project, tentatively titled Black Disability Politics. The larger project analyzes how issues of disability, broadly construed, have been and continue to be incorporated into Black art and activism in the post-civil rights era from the 1970s to the present. Within, I define Black disability politics as anti-ableist arguments and actions performed by Black cultural workers which address disability within the context of anti-Black racism. Black disability politics are often performed in solidarity with disabled people writ large, but the articulation and enactment of Black disability politics does not necessarily center traditional disability rights language and approaches, such as disability identity and pride, civil rights inclusion, etc. The book, therefore, seeks to identify and analyze examples of Black disability politics in order to correct the frequent overlooking and misrecognition that has typically occurred in scholarly evaluations of disability in Black art and activism. I have also written, in addition to this work on the Panther Party, I've also written two chapters on the National Black Women's Health Project. These two organizations are my historical examples, and I rely on existing scholarship and archival data, particularly the publications of these two groups, to develop my arguments. I'm also currently, I'm going off script, working on interviews with contemporary Black disabled activists that'll form the final chapter of this book. In what follows, I will provide a historical overview of the Panthers and the 504 sit-in, followed by an analysis of the multiple ways that the BPP was involved with the demonstration and how they rhetorically positioned disability rights in relation to their larger activist goals and ideologies. I use the BPP's own explanation of their involvement, particularly via the Black Panther newspaper, to argue that Black disability politics were an integrative part of their revolutionary agenda, and to support my book project's larger goal of demonstrating the different ways that Black activists have engaged with disability as a political concern. I should add a content note here that I will be reading some quotes which sarcastically use ableist and racist language. So, historical backgrounds. The Black Panther Party was a revolutionary, anti-racist, anti-capitalist, anti-imperialist organization started in Oakland, California in 1966 by Huey P. Newton and Bobby Seale. The Panthers originally focused the bulk of their activities on armed self-defense and patrol of police within Black communities, rapidly obtaining national and international membership and influence. By December 1968, the party had offices in 20 cities, and by its membership and influence height in 1970, 68 cities had Black Panther Party chapters of varying sizes. In 1969, FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover referred to the BPP as, quote, a violence-prone Black extremist group, and then declared that the party, quote, without question represents the greatest threat to the internal security of the country, close quote. Over the course of several years, the FBI, via its covert counterintelligence program called COINTELPRO, targeted members and suspected members of the Black Panther Party, men and women alike, sometimes also their children, for surveillance, harassment, incarceration, and violence, with the aim of disrupting and discrediting the organization among the public, its allies, and members alike. Despite this explicit governmental suppression of the party and it's the chaos that it caused within the organization, the BPP adapted and continued its cultural, political, and community work in a somewhat smaller, though nonetheless influential form until 1982. This shift in the form and function of the Black Panther Party was reflected in changes to their 10-point platform, a document which defined the demands, beliefs, and investments of the party. The first version of the BPP's platform, drafted in October 1966, focused on freedom and the, quote, power to determine the destiny of our Black community, via calls for full employment and, quote, land, bread, housing, education, clothing, justice, and peace. In March 1972, however, the platform was revised in two key ways that reflected changes in the ideology and activities of the party. First, point one was changed to call for freedom and the power to determine the destiny of our Black and oppressed communities. Second, the 10 points were expanded to include a call for, quote, completely free health care for all Black and oppressed people, close quote. In this later era of the Black Panther Party, they began to more explicitly articulate and enact disability politics. For the majority of the party's existence from 1967 to 1980, the Black Panther newspaper, their intercommunal news service, served as one of the BPP's main political tools, providing a way to inform and politically educate members while also raising money. The 10-point platform, for example, was published at the end of every issue. The Black Panther included a wide range of news stories about injustices done to Black, brown, and poor people across the country, from police brutality and unfair legal proceedings to discrimination in employment, housing, and healthcare. The paper also featured advertisements for Panther programs, political cartoons, educational and theoretical articles on social issues, and international news from other revolutionary anti-imperialist causes. At its height, the party printed 150,000 copies of the Black Panther weekly, with national and international circulation. By the 1970s, the time period I'm going to be talking about today for them, the Black Panther was published around 5,500 copies per week and distributed nationally in select cities such as Los Angeles, Chicago, Detroit, and Milwaukee, where they still had chapters. By this period in the party's history, however, the bulk of the copies were distributed in California, especially the Bay Area, where the BPP was headquartered. This distribution information about the Black Panther matters substantially to my arguments about the party, because even though by the 1970s, the BPP's on-the-ground community work was happening almost exclusively in the Oakland area, the Black disability politics expressed within the paper still had wide reach and influence. It matters that Black people and other supporters of the party read about disability rights and disability politics in the Black Panther as being integral and an important part of widespread liberation and revolution. The 504 demonstration was a major successful milestone in the disability rights movement. It was a 25-day occupation of the San Francisco Regional Office of the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare, during which over 100 protesters refused to leave until the National Hue Secretary, Joseph Califano, his name's up there, signed into effect regulations of Section 504 of the 1973 Rehabilitation Act. This act was the first piece of federal legislation dictating civil rights for disabled people. Section 504 specifically stated that programs receiving federal funds, such as public schools, universities, and hospitals, could not discriminate against or exclude people on the basis of disability. While the Rehabilitation Act was signed by President Richard Nixon in 1973, Section 504 remained ineffective without written published regulations. After years of delays, so we're talking about passed in 1973, we're in 1977, the American Coalition of Citizens with Disabilities organized to agitate for official regulations of the Section 504 to be drafted and approved. When newly inaugurated President Jimmy Carter took office, his HUE officials attempted to create new regulations than those that were drafted under Ford. In response, this organization, ACCD, warned that if the regulations were not signed as is, the organization would stage sit-ins at HUE offices across the country on April 7th, 1977. While the protest, which occurred in Atlanta, Boston, Chicago, Denver, Los Angeles, New York City, Philadelphia, and Seattle, lasted for a few hours each, and the relatively large protest in Washington, D.C. lasted just over a day, the protests in San Francisco continued for weeks, thanks to careful planning and organizing by disabled activists in the Bay Area. The occupation of the HUE building in San Francisco garnered extensive local and national news coverage and has taken on legendary status within disability history and disability activist communities for its innovation and power. So now I'll talk specifically about what the Panthers were doing with the 504. The Black Panthers were involved with the 504 demonstration from start to finish, participating via the most commonly cited activity of providing daily food deliveries, as well as sending representatives to give speeches, putting out a press release endorsement, supporting two members of the party in their roles inside the protest, and publishing numerous articles in the Black Panther. I'm going to discuss each of these activities in turn. Nearly all accounts of the sit-in note that a major part of its success was due to extensive coalitional support. This support came in the form of volunteers, donations, and endorsements from a variety of other activist groups and organizations not focused on disability rights, but on gay rights, women's liberation, civil rights, and more. Organizers of the 504 demonstration secured this support in the planning stages of the protest and expanded their reach throughout the duration of the sit-in. While the Black Panther Party was not listed as part of the 504 Emergency Coalition in the first press released by the organized protesters, according to Holland DeLille, who acted as an insider, photographer, and press for the protest in her memoir about this event, BPP member Ellis White spoke at a rally on the first day of the demonstration. DeLille quotes White as later saying, quote, "We've always been involved. We've had reps here from the beginning. The issue is self-determination, more human rights, whether handicapped people have a right to survive. Whatever they do to ensure survival, we support. Califano threw drug addicts and alcoholics out of the handicapped group. They belong too. The issue is money. It's in keeping with our principles, survival." Here, White insists upon not only the early involvement of the Panthers in the 504 demonstration, but also how their involvement was directly in line with the party's principles, that is, their 10-point platform, which first and foremost called for freedom and self-determination for all oppressed communities. The Black Panther Party understood disabled people, along with other people of color, people in poverty, women, and gays and lesbians, to be fellow oppressed members of society who had to fight for survival in a racist and ableist capitalist system. The BPP's solidarity with disabled people in general, and the 504 protesters specifically, is further articulated in their April 8, 1977 press release, written and delivered by Michael Fultz, editor of the Black Panther. The statement reads, and this is a longer quote, quote, "Along with all fair and good thinking people, the Black Panther Party gives its full support to Section 504 of the 1973 Rehabilitation Act and calls for President Carter and HUE Secretary Califano to sign guidelines for its implementation as negotiated and agreed to on January 21st of this year. The issue here is human rights, rights of meaningful employment, of education, of basic human survival, of an oppressed minority, the disabled and the handicapped. Further, we deplore the treatment accorded to the occupants of the fourth floor and join with them in full solidarity. Like White's statement above, here, the party's official public endorsement also emphasizes human rights, survival, and solidarity among oppressed groups. The BPP's role, however, was not limited to being a supporter in name alone. The party also contributed in key material ways. First, two members of the party, Brad Lomax and Chuck Jackson, the disabled and non-disabled black men featured together on the May 7th cover of the Black Panther, were on the inside as part of the sit-in and also acted as two of the representative delegates to DC for the 504 coalition. As a member, as a disabled member of the Black Panther Party, Lomax worked to incorporate disability politics into the effort of the party. That said, as a rank and file member, and the party was a military style organization, there was hierarchy, so Lomax was a rank and file member. His work still had to align with the goals and ideology of the party. In an interview, former BPP member Elaine Brown asserts that Lomax's participation in the 504 demonstration and his work at the Center for Independent Living was considered part of his work for the party. Brown elaborates that while Brad Lomax, who became a wheelchair user after becoming a member of the party, and Ed Roberts, leader of the Center for Independent Living, brought awareness of disability rights to the Panthers, the party's existing ideological position of focusing on systemic change for all marginalized groups meant that further transforming their thinking to include disability politics was, quote, wasn't hard. This is what she says in the interview. Brown states that soon after being made aware of disability politics, the party ordered all of the party's buildings to install wheelchair access ramps. This is an example, therefore, of the key role that multiply marginalized individuals play in acting as a bridge between groups, fostering the further development of disability politics within the BPP. Indeed, Lomax was an essential figure whose multiply marginalized identities undoubtedly fostered the BPP's support of the 504 sit-in, their most direct involvement with disability rights. But that support could not have occurred without the existing revolutionary ideology that undergirded all of the Panthers' work. This is not to diminish Lomax's important historical role, but rather to acknowledge that the BPP's disability politics did not start, end, or rest entirely on the shoulders of one individual. As most accounts of the party's involvement in the demonstration state, the Panthers also contributed materially by donating food. More specifically, once it became clear that the sit-in was going to continue beyond a day or two, the party began bringing daily hot dinners such as fried chicken or meatloaf. The BPP also, according to Brown, brought in mobile showers for the protesters and supplied a form of security as well. While the exact form of this security is unclear, it is apparent that members of the party, familiar with the tactics of federal agencies and the police, ensured that supplies got through the door. For example, one Black Panther article stated that more than a week into the sit-in, quote, with all incoming telephone service abruptly cut off and all food denied entry, party members saw to it that a sympathetic guard discreetly allowed the breakfast food they had brought upstairs to the demonstrators, close quote. They just saw to it. We don't know how they did it. That's just saw to it. Similarly, in her memoir, Corbett O'Toole writes, quote, I happened to be in the lobby the first night that the Black Panthers brought us dinner. The FBI blocked them and told them to leave. The Panthers, being extremely sophisticated about how to manage police interactions, merely informed the FBI that they would be bringing dinner every night of the occupation. They would bring the food, they would set it up, and they would leave. If the FBI prevented them from doing that, they would go back to Oakland and bring more Panthers until the food got delivered to the protesters. The FBI soon backed down. Close quote. The material support provided by the Panthers in the form of members on the inside, food, and supplies was essential to the longevity of the protest. But perhaps most importantly for the historical record is the extensive coverage of the demonstration the party provided in their newspaper. The Black Panther provided the most national coverage of the 504 protest. Only a local paper, the San Francisco Chronicle, covered it more often. The party published 10 articles and announcements of varying lengths about the demonstration between April 16th and July 7th, 1977. After the demonstration ended, the 504 sit-in was mentioned an additional 8 times in the paper in related stories, such as protest systemic exclusion disabled sue AC transit, and disabled score victory over supermarket barriers, blind mother fights bias for custody of children. These articles typically featured events in which 504 protesters were involved, so they would mention it because this protester was now doing something else. The Black Panther coverage of the demonstration is significant because it meant that thousands of Black people were being informed of disability rights in a way that framed disability politics as directly connected to Black community concerns, as part of a larger radical agenda for freedom for all oppressed communities. The impact of a major Black activist organization directly supporting and increasing awareness of disability rights among Black Americans cannot be directly calculated. The national distribution of the Black Panther's coverage of the 504 sit-in disrupts the common narrative that people of color have primarily distanced themselves from disability and illustrates at least one way that Black activists embraced and understood disability politics as necessary and interrelated part of collective liberation overall. The articles in the Black Panther portrayed the sit-in as an important, necessary act, calling it, quote, a powerful and significant protest for human and civil rights of handicapped and disabled people. The rhetoric in the paper makes clear the connections between the disability politics being enacted by the sit-in and the work the party had already been doing to increase the freedoms of oppressed people. In the first article on the demonstration, for example, the paper noted that, quote, despite stereotypes and stigma, very much real and alive, protesters have embarked upon a serious drive to control and transform the oppressive conditions of their lives, close quote. The emphasis on oppression, stereotypes, stigma, and other socio-political concerns in the Black Panther's representation of the 504 sit-in presented readers a social model of disability that paralleled the BPP's own understanding of race and class oppressions. In an address at a victory rally at the end of the demonstration, leading member of the BPP, Erica Huggins, a former political prisoner who was denied adequate medical care during her own incarceration, made the connection of oppression explicit when she stated, and this is where I'll be, this section I'll be using some sarcastically used slurs, when she stated that, quote, the United States has always had its niggers, and they come in all sizes, shapes, colors, classes, and disabilities. The signing of the 504, this demonstration, the sit-in, this beautiful thing that has happened these past weeks, is all to say that the niggers are going to be set free. Close quote. To the Black Panther Party, therefore, disability rights were an obvious part of their goal to obtain freedom and self-determination for all oppressed communities. Here, abstracting niggers into a synecdoche for all those excluded and exploited within the United States, rather than as a term specifically tied to Blackness and race. As several scholars of race, gender, and disability have argued, oppression analogies, those in which one oppression is compared to another, while often intended as a way to promote connection or identify similarly, can easily end up reifying one oppression in the name of the other, erasing the presence of people located at the intersection of multiple oppressions, or appearing to rank one oppression as worse or more prevalent than the others. In the case of Huggins' speech, however, I would argue that her rhetoric does not negate or rank racism or ableism, while also leaving space for the intersection of Black disabled identity. Additionally, in line with the Panthers' critiques of the federal government in pretty much everything, the newspaper also highlighted the Ford and Carter administration's failures to follow through with implementing the 504 regulations. Unlike other nationally distributed newspapers, which often mention 504 regulation implementation costs and resistance rationales alongside coverage of the protest, the Black Panther focused on rights, access, and empowerment. The one time the newspaper did discuss the cost of mandating accessibility, it was in order to critique across a cost-benefit model of decision-making. The editorial article sarcastically asked, quote, "How much will it cost us for you people to have your human rights?" before then detailing the estimated cost alongside the profits the, quote, "newly employed disabled people will add to the gross national product." The article estimates that, quote, "to allow 35 million Americans to have equal access / barrier-free environment necessary to live full and decent lives will cost a little over 8.5 cents per disabled person." The editorial continues by stating, quote, "How much? Well, from the human point of view, a great deal more than the racists and reactionaries are willing to give up without a fight. If the rednecks and the others don't have cripples to hate and make fun of anymore, if niggers and the rest of the oppressed in this society aren't the enemy anymore, then who will all that anger and frustration built up within the silent majority be turned against?" Close quote. Here, once again, the party makes a direct connection between the operations of racism and ableism in ways that do not seek to compete or compare, but rather connect. As with oppression analogies discussed above, one of the concerns when analyzing marginalized groups discussing other forms of oppression is that those who are multiply marginalized are sometimes erased from the conversation. In the case of the Black Panthers' coverage of the 504 sit-in, however, Black disabled people and disabled people of color were prioritized. In addition to the direct involvement of Black disabled Panther Brad Lomax, the newspaper published an interview with Dennis Phillips, the blind Black man pictured on the May 7th cover. In the interview, Philip encourages his, quote, "brothers and sisters that are Black and that are handicapped to get up, get out there, we need you, come here, we need you, wherever you are, we need you," close quote. The interview with Phillips was edited, so the choice of what to include is purposeful. It is particularly important that the editors included the following statement from Phillips, quote, "I'm not a member of the Black Panther Party. I'd like to join the Black Panther Party. I am a member of the Black Panther Party as far as my own initiative and soul is concerned. They have fed us. They have given us respect. They have treated us as human beings," close quote. This quote not only reflects the BPP in a positive light, emphasizing their coalitional work, but it also suggests, by the fact that they chose to keep this quote, that the party wanted to highlight the potential for more Black disabled involvement and inclusion within their work via Phillips' statement. Additionally, this interview with Phillips and a later interview with Lomax together acknowledge the particularity of Black disabled people and other disabled people of color. A decade before the coining of the term intersectionality, Lomax referred to being Black as disabled as, quote, "multi-disabilities." While in another article on the congressional hearings at the San Francisco Hue office, the Black Panther made sure to include mention of a minority panel, that was literally what they called it, the minority panel, of four people, quote, "all of whom eloquently expressed the double whammy experienced by handicapped minorities," close quote. The choice to include explicit representations of disabled people of color demonstrate the BPP's commitment to intersectional thinking. Additionally, throughout their coverage of the demonstration, the Black Panther interviewed, quoted, and named several other individual protesters, often protesters of color, alongside the main white disabled leaders of the protests, such as Judy Heumann, Kitty Cohn, and Ed Roberts, who, along with Hue officials and politicians, were most often interviewed and quoted in other papers. So in my off script here for a moment, in my looking through other coverage of this, no other paper explicitly kind of talked about race in relationship to this sit-in. Only the Black Panther Party was doing that. The inclusion of so many rank-and-file protesters in the newspaper's coverage of the sit-in reflects the party's emphasis on the, quote, power of the people and the role that every individual has to play in a revolutionary agenda. All of this is not to say, however, that there was no ableism within the party or within its representation of disabled people and disability rights. The Black Panthers' coverage of the 504 demonstration occasionally used ableist language, such as describing the protest as most as inspiring or most poignant, while also repeatedly referring to Brad Lomax as being victimized by multiple sclerosis. This language, Schweik argues, reveals, quote, a general lack of disability consciousness, close quote, within the BPP. Schweik's choice of the term disability consciousness is essential here because it highlights that the Panthers were generally not yet aware of how language was being used and transformed within disability rights activist communities, even as they supported the work emerging from disabled activists. Going off script again, this is part of what this project I'm hoping to do is show that this language of like a lack of disability consciousness is reflected of a particular kind of consciousness that has been defined by the mainstream white disability rights movement. And so this project is trying to show that Black disability politics just look different. It's not that it doesn't exist. That said, within the overall rhetoric used within articles about the sit-in, the language leans towards progressive for its time, such as using both handicapped and disabled as descriptors. Furthermore, the intent was still predominantly aligned with a disability rights approach rather than a medical or charity model of disability that words like inspiring or victim might suggest. Of course, intention cannot be the sole basis for assessing ableist language. Oppression, discrimination, and harm can occur regardless of intention. Nonetheless, when analyzing potentially ableist language among people attempting to work in solidarity with disability communities, but who do not yet know the right, in scare quotes, language, there is utilitarian political value in reading closely and in context, including intention of the overall text and the frequency, severity, and style of use of potentially ableist language. While disability studies scholars and disability rights activists may want to completely banish certain slurs like the R word, other words like inspiring are not ableist in and of themselves, but rather are often used in ableist ways. There is value, therefore, in closer analysis of how language is being used in a specific context rather than merely identifying the existence of certain potentially ableist words. In the case of the Black Panther, inspiring was almost always used in conjunction with another adjective, such as inspiring and powerful protest, tremendous inspiring victory, or spectacular and inspiring victory, which, while not completely negating the potentially ableist implications, suggesting that what was most inspiring, the language itself suggests that what was most inspiring was the protest, power, length, and success, more than merely that it was done by disabled people. Importantly, the words inspiring and inspiration were never used to describe a disabled individual, but rather was used exclusively in reference to the protest, the victory, and once to the fact that the Black civil rights song, We Shall Overcome, was used as a, quote, unofficial theme song and source of hope and inspiration by the protesters. Reading the use of inspiring and inspiration in these specific contexts, then, and within the larger scope of the BPP's involvement with the 504 demonstration, I would not consider the use of this word ableist, though I would consider the repeated references to Lomax as a victim of his multiple sclerosis representative of latent ableist beliefs, even as Lomax was supported and respected as a member of the party. These two things can both exist. Taken as a whole, then, the Black Panther was perhaps imperfect in its execution. The party strongly supported the 504 demonstration in material and ideological ways because of their existing revolutionary agenda, seeking freedom and self-determination for all oppressed people. The BPP's support of the demonstration, in the form of public endorsements, members participating in the sit-in, delivery of food and other supplies, and extensive coverage in their newspaper, is representative of how the Panthers' ideology included space for Black disability politics. To conclude, the success of the 504 sit-in depended upon a number of factors: the planning, tenacity, and creativity of the protesters, the extensive media coverage which put pressure on politicians, even, ironically, the ableism of the employees at the Hue office, who deeply underestimated the resolve and capabilities of disabled people, notoriously patronizing protesters the first day by serving punch and cookies. So the folks didn't think that these disabled people would hang around. So they just like let them in because they were like, oh, look at you, you're so cute. And then they were like, we're here forever. So there you go. Sometimes you get a little like reverse privilege action. The occupation could not have lasted as long and safely as it did, however, without the extended network of supportive groups and organizations such as the Black Panther Party. Schweik argues that this support is often framed as coming from, quote, other activist groups in a way that erases the connections and overlaps between social justice organizations and individual identities. Taking up an expansive approach to identifying and analyzing Black disability politics addresses this potential eraser. In regard to the Black Panther Party specifically, understanding their enactments of Black disability politics requires looking beyond the singular, though important, moment of the 504 demonstration toward the party's additional engagements with disability and ableism, as I do in my larger project. Black disability politics are most often enacted within and alongside other not disability exclusive concerns, in specific relationship to race and class, and without explicit or focused engagement with the methods and languages of the mainstream disability rights movement. This is apparent, for example, in the Black Panthers' health activism via free clinics and awareness-raising ad and test campaigns for sickle cell anemia, as well as the party's collaboration with mental disability and MAD activists in protesting the return of psychosurgery. And that parts the subject of the second chapter that I write on the Panthers. Indeed, Black activism within and against the medical and psychiatric industrial complex is perhaps the most obvious location within which to locate Black disability politics, as the medical industrial complex has long been a primary battleground for disabled people. Importantly, however, the power of the disability system and the medical and psychiatric industrial complexes extend far beyond the explicit confines of doctors' offices, clinics, and hospitals into law, prisons, media, education, and other cultural arenas in which disability politics may be enacted. We see this in the party's founding of the Oakland Community School, which educated Black children who were pushed out of public schools and deemed uneducable, as well as the Black Panther newspaper's coverage of a lawsuit against California public schools' use of racist IQ test for special ed placement. While none of these issues or actions were explicitly framed as disability issues by the party, their involvement and attention to disability and health as racialized political concerns demonstrates that in order to understand Black disability politics, disability studies and Black studies scholars alike must expand our understanding beyond the framework of disability rights alone. Thank you.
Any questions?
Okay, so it looks like we're gonna take questions. Erin, thank you so much, has a mic. So if you would like to ask a question, please gesture at Erin, they will bring you a mic. Please just say your name, make sure it's working, and then ask me whatever you wanna ask.
In your thank you, first of all, for an amazing talk, and I feel like I've just learned so much. So I'm going to ask questions and hope that I learn some more.
Great.
So in your talk, you talk about how Jimmy Carter, when his administration went brought into the presidency, that he wanted to enact or to shift the regulations. Can you talk about what he was doing and what that really meant in relationship to the 504 regulations?
Yeah, so I don't even know that it was Carter specifically, right? Whoever, so his like national Califano, right, was taking over from someone else. So part of this was like a law was trying to be passed as like we were shifting hands, right? So that's a difficult moment. The things that came up mostly in the, so I haven't read like all of the Senate transcripts or anything about the passage, just, you know, some news coverage. So the things that were most controversial were what the Black Panther in their statement mentioned. So whether or not alcoholics and drug addicts should be considered disabled. So that was part of the back and forth. And then part of it was also a cap on money, like how much money, and this is all stuff that now comes up with ADA, like it's all about money. So it's how much money do we have to spend? Is there a cap on money? Is there, and so it was mostly coming from universities as well as mostly hospitals. Hospitals asking questions about what does it mean to discriminate? What discrimination is allowed. So it was these like clarification of terms and then money issues that kept shifting. And so they wanted, basically they wanted to come in and reevaluate. It wasn't even clear, I think, exactly what they wanted to change, but they were like, well, this is ours now. We want time to look over it before we pass something that had been drafted by another administration. And that's when people were like, nah, this has already taken us 4 years. It's taken us 4 years to get this far, and now you want to go into another drafting stage? No, that's not going to happen. So that's when the protests were organized. Yeah. It's also okay to not ask questions. Sometimes they take a while to percolate.
So in your talk, you were talking a little bit about different ways that specifically Black formulations of disability and disability justice are showing up in history. And I'm just wondering, I'm sure this is the book, but like, could you just talk a little bit more about what you think that does, and some provocations or things you're thinking about?
Yeah. So again, I'm working with the Panthers and the National Black Women's Health Project. So just two organizations as a preliminary. I'm really trying to think of this book as like something to throw out into the world and be like, hey, y'all see that? You want to talk about that together? Let's do it. Because I'm not a historian and I don't have all the skills that I need to like do this in mass, in full. There's so many things that I've come across. So mostly I'm using it as a way of signaling some of the themes that I see, what I'm calling the qualities of Black disability politics, to identify the ways that it might look differently. So one that came up here already is like disability identity and pride, that often the language of disability claiming the name of being disabled is not in what we're finding now. Or what I'm finding now, we, all of us, I don't know. It's not in there, right? So when I'm searching, for example, within the Panther Archive, I have to just sit, I have a list of like 30 terms. And so it might be like deaf, blind, paralyzed, crippled, right? Like all of these other words, but not disability. So if you're looking for the word disability, it's not gonna be there. But you might find, for example, an article about a woman who has multiple sclerosis who can't find housing for her and her children that's accessible to her. But it just says, like, mother with MS, like, can't find housing, right? So if you're just looking for that and looking for it to be framed in that way. So that's one of the main things, is like this idea of disability identity, disability pride being central to what makes disability politics is not going to work if we're looking for Black disability politics. Even now, with the interviews that I'm talking about, I'm talking to activists who are claiming this, but many of them talk about working with Black disabled folks who at best will say, I have a disability or I'm on disability, but will not kind of claim that as an identity. So we need to think about that as a parameter for what it means to be like a political disabled person. Other things that we see or that I'm seeing in terms of qualities are like an emphasis on race with disability included. So disability may not be the center of the story, right? That housing story is about fair and affordable housing, but it's also about accessibility, right? But that's not the framework. So if you're looking again for that framework, it's gonna be a race-centered but still intersectional approach. It being very historicized and contextualized is another aspect that I talk about, where if we're talking about access to healthcare, for example, some of the stories on sickle cell anemia will also include like long narratives about how research on this disease that highly impacts Black folks is like deeply underfunded, right? So it always gets put in these other larger historical and political contexts that aren't just emphasizing like the particular lives of disabled folks, even as they're included in it. They're talking about this is one of many things of ways that we are being like marginalized and harmed by like a medical industrial complex. So again, contextualized, historicized, intersectional, but race-centered, not centering disability, pride, or identity. And then the other thing is just like broad and holistic. I'm still working on these labels, so that's why I'm like, I'm working on what I'm gonna call this in the book, but these very broad and holistic. So the National Black Women's Health Project is a good example of this, where they're a health organization. So again, the way they're talking about disability is very inclusive of things like HIV, chronic illnesses, depression, in ways that the disability rights movement in that moment was not talking about those things. We now have more folks in disability studies and disability rights talking about chronic illnesses, psychiatric and mental disability, but that was not was what was at the center. At the time, the MAD activists at the time were not necessarily working with the disability rights folks, because disability rights folks were seeking accommodations typically on a very physical level. So they weren't always working together. So that's another aspect, just like very broad approaches that's, again, maybe not focused on disability alone. And then the last aspect is just the micro-macro divide, that they're constantly kind of juggling between those two things. And so, again, even though Black disabled people are involved, they may not be the leaders, they may not be the primary voices. And so if that's what we're valuing, if that's what we're saying constitutes disability politics, is that it's being done by Black disabled people, that might not be happening in some of these spaces. It may be folks who are working on health issues like the spread of HIV in like Black poor communities, and they may not be folks who identify as having a disability and may not have HIV themselves, but they are connected to folks. And we know in the disability rights history that that's part of it. Like parents were some of the first folks, parents of disabled children, to be like, my kid deserves to go to school. And then disabled folks were provided more education and then were able to like advocate for themselves over time. But I think our understanding of it now is so based in that thing. So those are some of the qualities that I'm looking at, that the hope of this project is that by identifying some of these qualities, then folks can go back to whatever it is, whether it's literature, history, like anywhere, just anywhere, go look at the spaces where black folks are doing often like health related work and see it as actual disability politics, even as the language and approaches, again, like may not look like what we would consider disability rights work today. That was a lot. Okay, yes.
As much as you're willing to share, I'd be curious to hear about the people that you're talking to now, the contemporary activists, mm-hmm, and how you see Black disability politics playing out in the present day.
Yeah, so very new into this. So I mean, I've been doing interviews. I've interviewed 7 people over the course of the last 2 months. So when I'm in it, I'm actively in it. So right now, mostly just like sending a lot of emails, trying to track people down. But I'm starting with the Harriet Tubman Collective. If folks aren't familiar, the Harriet Tubman Collective is a collective of Black disabled activists who organized under that name in 2016. I should know that by now. But anyway, 2016, I'm pretty sure. Specifically in response to the movement for Black Lives. So when Black Lives Matter became one organization, then the Movement for Black Lives was another organization that was basically a coalition of a bunch of different kind of Black activists and political social organizations that kind of came together under this label, the Movement for Black Lives. And they released a statement that was basically a policy platform statement of like the vision for the Movement for Black Lives, and it did not mention disability. I think it might have, because it came out, there were a couple iterations of it. At some point it had the term differently abled, and then like that was it. And so they basically released this statement in response, and then the Movement for Black Lives has now incorporated disability into that platform with kind of in conversation with this group. So I'm starting with members of that group, Velissa Thompson, Heather Watkins, Dustin Gibson. I'm supposed to be talking to Patrick Coakley next week, hopefully, we'll see. So kind of getting those folks, and then basically snowballing from there into folks that are doing this work, primarily on Twitter. So the big thing that I'm trying to do with this contemporary chapter is, one, like, mark what's happening with the Harriet Tubman Collective, because I think that's an important moment for Black disability politics, where this group came out and was like, hey, like, biggest like Black activist movement to emerge like within our lifetime, you have to have disability, and people are actually responding to that. Like, that's huge, that's important. So I wanna mark that. I think one thing that I'm seeing with the conversations is the claiming of disability, where folks are like, I personally claim it, it's important to me. Most folks are also saying, and if other people don't, I'm still gonna work with them, I'm still gonna help them understand like why they need to have a political consciousness about this, whether or not they ever want to use that term. So I think that that is an interesting like shift in the way that like disability is being talked about. Let's see, what else from these interviews? Yeah, I'm still, I literally haven't even like, I've just done the interviews, I haven't even looked at transcriptions yet. But one thing that's come up that I'm working through, I don't know, anybody do like religious stuff in this room? No? Like, scholarly, not personal. I'm not asking you about your religious lives. Okay, cool. In the National Black Women's Health Project, my chapters on that, they include spiritual health as part of the way they understand health. So mental, physical, and spiritual health. And multiple folks in these interviews have talked about the role of the church, and particularly the kind of lack of political engagement with disability in the Black church, and the way that church can and spirituality can potentially be like a barrier. That's like a thing that I don't know how to do yet, as someone who like is not particularly religious, Reformed Catholic, and there's no tools in disability studies. There's very limited work. Most of it is like very focused on either like problems with faith healing, discrimination in churches, or like specific engagement with representations of disability in the Bible. Very little work on like what do we do, and how do we talk about Black disabled people or disabled people in general who have like deep religious and spiritual lives, and not in a way that is like internalized ableism, but like really. So in the National Black Women's Health Project, there are people who talk about the importance of faith in like not healing, but in like helping them adjust, of making them feel like they could get through a particular health moment. So there's one I'm thinking of with a woman who had cancer, that she was like, without like God and my faith community, I would not have made it through. And we don't have a way of talking about that. So those are kind of the things that are coming up. Like, how do we talk about disability and faith, spirituality practices, and engage with the ways that they like may be helpful, may be hurtful. Both of these things are possible. And that I don't know. So that's an ongoing thought process in my head. Yeah. Thanks for asking.
Thank you. Thank you so much for all the information. I'm going to ask about a couple things, and you feel free to just respond to whatever sticks.
Sure.
Yeah. One thing is, I'm really struck by the way that you're talking about the importance that people read about it in BPP, the importance that people read about it at all,
mm-hmm.
And the importance that what I'm hearing is that you can find this now, that it was written about and read about in this way.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering if you could speak a little bit to the value of being able to read this history in context, as someone who's not a historian as well, what this type of archival intervention adds to the way that you can interpret the work. I'd love to hear about that. I'm also, if you get around to it, really interested in, you mentioned a couple of times how administrative bodies as kind of the wall against progress in this narrative basically weren't able to compute the intersections that are in these people's lives,
mm-hmm.
right? And I'm wondering if you have come across any perspectives around the failures of the process of seeking things like 504 to turn intersectional rights into reality, and if you have any thoughts on that from your research.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, so first part, tell me it again. I should have written it down. No, it's okay. It's totally fine.
Just about the value of the archival documentation.
Value of the archive. Absolutely.
Yeah.
So what I have learned from doing this project as someone who is not 100% not a historian, trained in like gender studies, literary studies, but newspapers are text. I was like, it's text. It's just text. That's all it is. It really made clear to me how important access to archives are, and going back to the archives, because the way I got into this project was I read Alondra Nelson's Body and Soul, which is about the health activism of the Black Panther Party. I don't even know why I read it, because it had nothing to do with what I was working on. I think I was just like, this was an award-winning book. I think also someone told me it was like her dissertation, so they were like, this is a good example of like a first book. So I was like, okay, I'll read this. And there was literally one sentence where she quoted Irving Zola, who's like kind of considered one of the first disability studies scholars in the late 80s. And in that moment, I was halfway into this book and I was like, oh, this is a book about disability, like this is disability studies. This book is disability studies. And it's not just, but it's in here, but she's not citing anything else that's disability studies, but particularly her conversation around the representation of like folks with sickle cell anemia and that those campaigns. And I was like, this is disability. So I just wanted to see it, and I looked at a couple of different things, and again, found the articles on the 504 sit-in by disability studies folks who were like, the Panthers brought food, it was great. And then Sue Schweik's one article on Lomax, and I was like, okay, that's there. They did the 504 sit-in. I couldn't find anything else talking about disability. And then I go into the archive, which luckily has been, the newspapers have all been, almost all have been digitized. So nice. So, you know, from the comfort of my home, was going through this archive over several months, and there's so much in there about disability. But because the folks who are doing Panther research, right, don't have that lens, weren't thinking about disability at all. I have met with Alondra Nelson, who was like, yeah, not what I was thinking about, right? So I don't know if it's in there or not. It's not in the Panther research. And then the disability studies scholars are interested in this one moment that they know about. So that's all they're looking for. They're just looking for the 504 sit-in. They're not looking across the board of everything that the Panthers published, right? So it took me going back and looking at those original sources to be like, it's right there. It's right there again and again and again and again. And so I think that that's the value of getting into the archive, is because we have a perspective as like contemporary scholars, as scholars who are trained in new and interdisciplinary ways, that folks who have already written about this archive, who have already been in there, they weren't looking for that. They weren't thinking about that. And so that to me is the value of these primary sources. rather than reading just what other historians have already written and hoping that they're going to provide you something, because it's not in there. I've read a lot of things on the Panthers. It's not in there. They might talk about the health activism in the clinics, but they're not talking about disability politics in particular. And really, Alondra Nelson's book is like the only one that's extensively talking about the health stuff. So I think that's the value of the archive. Okay, second half is Tell Me Again. Mm-hmm. Well, I think that the thing is that none, like, the work that I'm doing, so I don't want it to be like, oh man, those other people sucked, like they're so dumb. No, like, I could not be doing this work without the work that has already been done. I couldn't have decided or been interested in this without the extensive work that Alondra Nelson did, and she left like that one little seed that I like took off and ran with to like plant somewhere else. So when we think about this in terms of like activist work and organizing work, it's a similar thing. Like, yes, do I wish that like from the start people would have been invested in like an intersectional approach? Of course. But realistically, the way that things got done, it wasn't that way. What we're seeing now in disability justice, so I want to distinguish between disability rights and disability justice. Disability justice is a term that was coined by disabled and queer people of color in the early 2000s. Leroy Moore, Patty Byrne, many of the folks involved with Sins Invalid, Mia Mingus, they coined that term as a way to emphasize intersectional approaches to disability politics. So this means recognizing the way that racism and ableism are tied to one another. It means recognizing that like capitalism is killing all of us, right? And so our bodies are all being like challenged by a system that doesn't value us. And so really forcing us to say that like the only way to do this, the only way to dismantle these systems is to see how they're all connected. Because anytime we do work where we're like, wait, you're gonna have to wait, then we find out that there's all these problems, there's all these issues with the way that we have set up these structures. So that's what a disability justice approach is doing. That's what I'm hoping this, like, the last chapter will be a way of being like, this is the new framework, please start using this. A big hope for this project is that hopefully it can be written and produced in a way that is accessible to activists and to folks outside of the academy, because part of this work, my hope is to get people to really feel invested in doing a disability justice approach in any activist work that they do, because I fundamentally believe if you ignore ableism and don't address disability, like, the movement will fail, particularly when we're talking about anti-black racism, which is so dependent upon constructions of black folks as disabled to function. And so if we can't address ableism, we will continue to fail, or the world will end. So we'll find out. Thank you. Thanks for coming, y'all.
Just a quick reminder, we'll see y'all next week, Wednesday, for Arnold Kemp.